Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Come on in. Please, as you're coming in, please write down, please type in the comments the state and city where you're from. Good evening, everyone. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. God bless you. Blessings to everyone that's coming on. Please, as you're coming on, share with someone and let them know that we are here. Come on in, come on in. Blessings to everyone that's coming on. Stephen Hurd, God bless you. I've been trying to get in touch with you. Stephen Hurd, I've been trying to get in touch with you. Can you send me your information through my inbox if you don't mind? God bless you, Deacon White. From North Carolina. Bless you, Lynn from Ardmore. God bless you. Yes, Stephen, this is on Facebook and YouTube as well. Yes, absolutely. I'm honored to see you. Honored. God bless everyone that is coming in on tonight. God bless you. Please let me know where you're coming from. My guest is here, and he's raring to go, and I don't want to hold him up. He's a very busy man. But as you're coming on, I have a couple of announcements that I would like to make. I have a couple of announcements that I would definitely like to make. Tomorrow, my Real Talk will be coming on tomorrow night, which is Tuesday. Hearing from the prophets. You don't want to miss it. They're going to share some things that God has downloaded into them. So please come back on tomorrow night to join me on Hearing from the Prophets. And also, I will be back on Thursday night. I will be on Thursday night. And my special guest will be Bill Jolly from Philadelphia and Henry McMillan. So you don't want to miss Thursday night. You don't want to miss tomorrow night, Hearing from the Prophets, and I will be on at 8 o'clock on tomorrow. And also, I am looking for tenors and altos for a special project that I will be working on. So if you're interested, you can send me an inbox or go to my email, which is ms.cindybarber@gmail.com. And I also would like to thank everyone that has participated with me as far as being a blessing through the Cash App. God is really blessed, and I want to thank you. Also, people all often ask me to share that information. My Cash App information is on the screen right now. So I want to thank those that have been a blessing and giving to me. I appreciate it. So right now, I'm going to bring my guest on, and everybody knows him. Those of you that are coming on, God bless you. God bless you. And here he is, none other than Professor and Dr. Stephen Ford. Good evening, Steve.
Good evening, Cindy. How are you?
I'm good. I'm so excited to have you with me on tonight. And I know you are extremely busy. So I don't take it lightly for you being on with me tonight. And I know we've been trying to catch up with each other for about a year. I've been trying to get you on here for about a year. So I'm so excited to see you. And I just want you to begin to share with us some of your, because I know you can't tell it all in one setting, but I want you to begin to share some of your music journey. And then I'll ask you some questions in between. So if you want to get started with sharing your music journey.
Well, I will. But before I start, I want to say thank you so much for inviting me to be a part of your journey. Even though you might say it's been a year, but I've been watching you.
Really?
So I've seen what God has been doing in your life, and we go back. So
yes.
As you know, my response to you was, you know, I want to do this for my sister, and you,
yes,
you've been such a dear friend to me, and you know, it's just good to be nice, and
it is.
I think that means so much, and to let people know how much you appreciate them. And you've always been, you know, you've always been the same since I've known you. And we probably need to talk about, you know, when that happened, because that's part of my journey too.
Right.
And the Lord knows you have patience. So yeah. If you say, oh, yeah, we've been trying. I feel terrible, but
No.
It's been a wonderful journey. I will say that.
Yes.
God has been so faithful to me, and this is probably the first time I'm actually just doing something like in this setting, just to kind of just sit and talk with a friend and just, you know, just share. As you know, and many may not know, but I'm really quiet. I'm quieter than people think. So
yes,
if you ever spend time with me, you'd probably be shocked to find out, even in growing up, the noisemakers was Andy, Michelle, and those are the two noisemakers. And Holly and I, we're the quiet ones, right? So, it's been the favor of the Lord, favor of the Lord. And so, I guess, you know, for me to kind of just get started with my story, and so I can stay on script. So
it's okay.
Let me say that it started with my parents, of course, and then of course all of us, you know, that's how we got here. But I have to point to my father and my mother, the late Bishop Andrew Ford and Alrita Ford. My father was my pastor, and I talk about that all the time. But what many people may not know is that my father was a very accomplished musician. He was a very accomplished guitarist. And he was self-taught. But one thing I must let everyone know that my father actually taught himself how to read. He actually got a lot of music books, and he worked it out. And so he could do chord charts. He could, you know, read rhythm charts. He could do that. And it was so funny because as we grew up, we had the church on Girard Avenue, which many may remember, this little small storefront church. Everybody the telephone booth, but my siblings and I, we would remember where my dad used to sit. He used to sit beside the piano or the organ. It was a chair where he would sit and play, and he would pat his foot. So over the years, you know, you have this indentation in the floor. he would really get into it, and he was just praising the Lord and pat his foot. My musical ability started with my dad and, of course, my mother. My dad was actually influenced by Wes Montgomery, that style, who was a jazz guitarist. And actually, Wes Montgomery was a jazz guitarist from Indianapolis. So, and that wasn't a place that was really known for musicians. I mean, back in the day, you know, jazz musicians really came from Chicago or New York. At that era, you know, and from New Orleans, and they migrated north. But Wes Montgomery had this unique style of playing octaves. He had, and actually, if you read his history, he kind of adapted that style because he was actually an iron worker. He worked with steel, and he played guitar at night. And so, with his occupation, if you know anything about handling steel or, you know, anything like that, while your hands can really get kind of worn and So his style, he would play octaves, and he actually thought that that wouldn't be really exciting, but he created this really unique way of approaching the guitar. My dad used to play like that. And my mother was a pianist. My mother played piano. And she really, she was kind of the quiet type, like Dolly and me, right? You didn't know what she could do. And my mother played for the choir at my father's, my mother started ministry together. Choir that they had was called the Christian Echoes. And way back now, and people used to come from all over to hear the Christian Echoes. And that was my father, my mother, and Uncle Thomas, who played organ and Aunt Dolores. So, and my father was a twin. So it was like a family affair, you know? And so that's kind of all I heard. All I've heard was music. And that's, you know, it was my life. I was born into music. And I often talk about this, and I won't go into a whole lot of detail, but I remember, I think I was about 7 years old, 7 or 8 years old.
Right.
Coming home with my, we was coming home from a Bible study. And, I remember my father, mother, you know, it was time for us to go to bed. And I remember walking up the steps to go to my bedroom. And when I got to the top step, like right as I stepped on the top landing, the top step there, it felt like I stepped into an oven. And even to this day, I remember it. It felt like I just stepped right into an oven. And, you know, my parents and my brother tell me about the experience. You know, I just started praising the Lord. I just start, you know, saying, thank you, Jesus, and just just praising God. And it was like I was on fire. I couldn't just move. And they said I passed out. And after that, of course, I don't remember anything. But I do remember weeks after that, anything I heard, I would be able to go to the piano and start picking it out, like playing it and playing the melody and following it. And so my father let me start playing at church. I think I was around eight or so. And then my uncle's job, he actually moved to Jersey, started working more out of Jersey, which means that he couldn't be there much. And I started playing more. And by nine, by the age of nine, I was playing for, we had like five choirs, the youth choir, the youth choir, you know, men's choir. We had all these choirs.
Did you play for those?
I was playing for every, the choirs, teaching the parts. But I would say this to many of the musicians out there, you know, I really had a complex. Now, let me tell you what that complex was. Well, I learned to play playing with my dad. My dad played the guitar, and he played in E and A and B. Those were like kind of the principal keys. Keys for the guitar. So those are the first keys I learned how to play in. So when we, when I would play with other musicians and they say, play a song, and I started E, everybody looking at me like, Steve, what's the matter? What, can you take that down to E flat?
Not E.
Why are you starting there? But I will tell you, it's my dad's fault, okay? Everybody knows it's my dad's fault. Yeah, so, and to kind of fast forward, I played for the church. Everything was church. I mean, you know, we come from the old time holiness church. So at that time we had service every night. Now I know people probably can't even imagine what that was about. But we had church every night. But here was the positive part about that. That means that every night I was actually playing. And then we had testimony service, which means, you know, somebody would just get up and start singing a song. He's a wonderful savior to me, whatever. And you had to get that song quickly, because if you went up and down the keyboard, my father would say, bless you, son. Bless you. God bless you.
So like, we knew that, man.
Like, reel you in. Like, no, you got to get that song right away. Now, mind you, most of the songs kind of all all sounded alike at one time.
Yeah, but all of us.
What I'm saying is by doing that every night, it just helped develop my musicianship, my endurance, helped me walk through a whole, I would say, just building, not to be nervous, because that became my life.
Yes, absolutely.
So I'll fast forward. I really loved like all types of music. So I listened to everything from reggae to country western. Just loved it all. Just loved it all. Mm-hmm. But there was one style of music, of course, R&B, and of course we're from Philadelphia, so Gamble and Huff are, you know, all of that.
Yeah.
But I remember my first time listening to the Philadelphia Orchestra with Eugene Ormandy, and I just could not believe what I was hearing. You know, you can hear an orchestra on the movies, and I like to hear the movies and the cartoons to hear the orchestra.
Yeah.
But to be able to just hear it live and just to feel just the energy in the room, I was hooked. And so I just loved the orchestra, the instruments.
All the instruments.
And shortly after that, being that I was, you know, still in school, back in that day, and I should say back in the day, we were able to sign out instruments. And so I was bringing every instrument home I could, the clarinet to the trumpet, the cornet.
Wow.
Everything I could get my hands on, I was bringing home, until I know my mother was like, don't you bring something.
Another instrument.
But I enjoyed it. And that's, it was like the music was just drawing me. It's just drawing me. Like I couldn't stop.
Yeah.
And then how I settled on playing the viola. Now I was a violist, and that was because the violins, my cousin Kenny Ford, he lives in Los Angeles. We all kind of was on the same age. You had Tommy, Andy, Kenny, myself, Terry, Michelle, Tony, Dolly. And Kenny played the violin. But I was going to, you know, settle down to the violin, but they didn't have any more violins left. So they had a viola. So and I started studying the viola.
Right.
I played the viola in the All City Orchestras under Dr. Shostak. And then started studying piano with different teachers. There were some challenges with me studying piano because I had already been playing by ear for quite a long time.
Right.
And it was a problem because some of the teachers that I was being sent to just couldn't understand or just didn't have the experience in teaching someone who already played by ear.
Right.
So I kind of bounced around a few teachers, finally settled with one teacher, Dr. Caruso. I studied with him for a while. And then by that time, I was going to Sulzberger Junior High School. Now, anybody from Philadelphia, in West Philadelphia, Sulzberger Junior High School was the place.
Okay.
And my teacher, when I got to Sulzberger, was Vera Eubanks. Now, Vera Eubanks is the mother of Kevin Eubanks, who was the musical director for the Tonight Show.
Really? Wow.
So she was my teacher and then went on further and moved on, went to Dobbins High School where I studied electronics. I was electronic major, electronics there for my career because I really was just, I loved, you know, gadgets. I loved to take things apart and put it back together.
Yes.
After I left Dobbins, I actually worked for RCA for a while. And that kind of ties into some other things when I talk about, you know, the time that I spent there. Then coming out of high school, you know, went to Temple University for just about a year. And at that time, really got involved, actually before that, really got heavily involved in the recording. My first time in the studio as far as just recording a project was Irving Brockington. Now, he just passed, of course, Brockington. Mm-hmm. And, but he gave me my first opportunity to really arrange and just have the freedom to kind of express myself musically. He trusted me. And at that time, I think I was about 14 years old.
Really?
And, I did his project. And then I just fell in love with the studio. Now, we did work down at Virtue and Philadelphia. Anybody, you know, from the Philadelphia area, you remember there was a studio called Virtue Studio. It was on Broad Street, right near Temple University on the second floor.
Mm-hmm.
Frank Virtue was the engineer.
Mm-hmm.
And I started doing, you know, mini sessions for him. He would always tell me, I don't have no money, Steve. I don't have no much money. And it didn't really matter to me because then it gave me a chance to be in the studio.
Yeah.
And, and then that led to other things and other things and other things.
Yes.
And it's so much when I, just for me to kind of think of it, it can kind of be overwhelming. So
yes,
I'll leave out some things just so I can get through it.
Right.
some of the milestones for me was, I would say, Gabriel Hardeman. A lot of people, that was kind of a big opportunity for people to hear my style of playing the organ. And my style, I thought, was just a little odd because I wasn't actually listening to organist. I was actually, you know, playing with my dad. So, you know, we didn't have a bass player. My dad would say, okay, well, you know, you give me the bass, you know, you keep the bottom. And, you know, he'd be like, keep it simple. Keep it simple. Don't be playing too many notes. Keep it simple. You know, and that allowed me to, you know, get a style wherein my organ style. And then he would say, be expressive. And my father was, he was a unique musician. And many people just know him by his preaching and Bible teaching.
Yeah.
But he was a music man. He was really a music man.
Mm-hmm.
And he and my mother, when you hear the Ford Memorial sound, you hear the anointed voices.
Yes.
You have to take it back to who really originated it, and the vibrato and the.
Yes.
My father also used to hate long intros, so if you ever hear the anointed voices, you always notice that they'll go right into it. In other words, they're gonna hit you. With, that comes from dad, because my dad would be like, "Get up there and sing. Don't give us a testimony. Don't give us a sermon. You're supposed to sing. Get up there and sing." And he would say to me, you know, play the intro, play it so people know what you're playing.
Yeah.
You know, don't be doing all this, you know, fancy stuff.
Right.
Play it. And that helped me. You
know, my goodness.
So when I go back to, you know, Gabriel Hardeman, I think that the song that brought attention was Feel Like Fire. That started a whole, bringing attention to what I did. And then from there, I started doing work for John Daniels. John Daniels was the producer for Tomato Line. That was like his big thing, but he had already been working at Savoy and Creed and various records. And how I connected with John Daniels was through Jonathan Harley. I don't know what that name sounds familiar, but he was a drummer.
Okay.
And we connected, and John Harley told John Daniels about me, and John Daniels called me to a session. And when I got to the session, first of all, when he called, I said, you know, will I get a chance to go to the rehearsals or anything? He said, no. He said, just, you know, come on to the studio. And what John Daniels would do is he would put on, back then it was the 2-inch reels. He'll put on a reel.
Right.
And he told the engineer, he said, just push the record button.
Right.
And
yeah.
I was like, you're not going to play the song for me? He said, no. Just push the record button. And then mm-hmm. we'll start playing. And he would push the record button and I would just play. I'd never heard the songs before. I would just play. He would record it. And even I was like, okay, I think I missed a chord or two. He'd say, no, don't worry about that. Let's go to the next song.
Really?
I go to the next song.
Uh-huh.
And it was quartet song. So I was used to playing with my dad. So you kind of know what chord is. You kind of know some patterns that's going on. So,
right.
And eventually what he used to do is call me and I would work for him like mm-hmm. all day Saturday. We'd start Saturday morning around 10. I would mm-hmm. finish maybe around 8 o'clock at night.
Really?
And many times I would cover like maybe two or three albums in that day. And he would just put, without rehearsing, without hearing anything.
Wow.
He would just push. And he said he was doing that because whatever I played the first time, it was creative enough that we would just build upon it. So my time spending with John Daniels really helped me
mm-hmm.
learn a lot about production, a lot about working fast, and then a lot about creating a discipline to get a lot of work done as far as production, which helped me as I got older
mm-hmm.
because, you know, recording companies, record labels, you know, they want volume. So they want to make sure that if you can pump out good material and you can, they can send it to you, they can depend on you,
mm-hmm.
then you build that kind of rapport. So
right.
that, I would say that came from working with John Daniels. And
wow.
then things kind of started exploding because
mm-hmm.
Other engineers started hearing my name and
mm-hmm.
calling me in to do work. And I really built a reputation as far as being a studio musician. And then I, you know, started doing more arranging. People trusted me in doing arranging and I was able to start arranging more.
Mm-hmm.
Fast forward, Jeff Davis, who was one of my best friends, he's resting in the arms of Jesus now, but
okay.
Jeff was from Jersey City in that area.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there was a community there, you know, Jersey City, New York, Connecticut.
Right.
And the musicians there, they have like a pack, you know, they kind of all know each other, you know, it's like a clique, it's like a brotherhood. And Jeff heard me play. He actually shared that information with Hubert Powell. And I think somewhere around in that time, I met you or the Barbers. Around that time.
Yeah. Hubert Powell.
Yep. And then Jeff then started playing for Richard Smallwood. And Jeff told Richard Smallwood about me. And I got connected with Richard. I loved it because Richard is just the ultimate musician, ultimate writer, but his classical knowledge is just unparalleled. And because I was already, you know, studying classical music, I had that kind of, I would say, pedigree
mm-hmm.
really connected. And so I worked for Richard for a long time with the Smallwood singers. I remember the first major project was the Textures project, and
mm-hmm.
But let me tell everybody just a little insight on that. We were in Nashville, and the owner of the studio's name was Robert Putnam, and they had just purchased a new digital machine and some new equipment.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm gonna tell Robert's business a little bit, but but while we were there, and any of the Smallwood singers, of course, Richard, if he's on, he'll remember this. Robert had just started dating a new girlfriend, and that might not mean much to anybody,
right.
but it was heaven's gift for me, and let me tell you why. Robert would set up the room and everything would get going. And then Robert would just, once he found out that I knew a little bit about the studio, he would just leave me in the studio. And he'd say, I'll see you tomorrow.
Wow. So
it gave me the chance to just have fun. And I actually, you know, spent nights in the studio working on the Center of My Joy record. And and that was, I believe that that experience just opened up a deeper relationship with Richard and I, because first of all, it was an honor to just work with him.
Yeah,
because Richard is very meticulous. He is. You think you got to know it right, and
right.
You know you can't be cluttering up this space for the vocals. No. You got to know what you're doing.
Yeah,
and I call him the subdominant king. I mean, you gotta play the dominant to the tonic, subdominant. You gotta know how he's doing what he's doing.
Oh, yeah,
I don't want you to put no jazz chords in there. I want a pure dominant seven to go to the next dominant seven.
Right. Leave it that way.
Right, and so. He trusted me after that, and then the rest is history as far as Richard and I. I'm going to fast forward to my time with the Winans. Traveling with Richard, we went all over the place and did some plays with him, Sing Mahalia Sing with Jennifer Holliday and others. I kind of mentioned this, I wrote it down. I think it was in 1986. The Winans actually came to the Dell in Philadelphia with Vanessa Bell Armstrong.
Yes.
And that's when I met them, I was introduced to them by Andrew Goucher, who plays bass for, Andre and others. Mm-hmm. And that's how I got connected with the Winans.
Wow.
But there was another thing that I'll save until, you know, questions to talk about technology back in the 80s and what that meant to my career and how that connected to me being a gadget person, just loving electronics. That helped me to be exposed to synthesizers and samplers back in the 80s. So it was like being on the cutting edge and thinking ahead. We'll talk about that a little later. So let me kind of just get through this real quick. So anyway, so now I'm with the Winans. And when I say we traveled the globe, I went through passport books after passport books. The Winans was probably, I would say, the gospel Beatles at that time. And overseas, just went everywhere. A lot of responsibility as the musical director. It opens up so many doors as far as, you know, people in the industry, people in TV, people in movies. I got involved with doing scores for movies.
Wow.
And then fast forward to the 90s, and Richard called me back. As a matter of fact, I remember the phone call Richard shared with me. He said, you know, Stephen, the Lord called me to put together another group, and I won't do the project without you. And of course, you know, somebody might feel like, you know, oh, wow, you know, that's a stroke of ego, or, you know, but they don't understand how much it was an honor, of course.
Yes.
But how much pressure and how much expectancy that was.
Yeah.
Then I realized that everything that God had brought me through from my first session with Brockington at 14 years old, all the way to that point in my life, preparation just to do that one project, and now I get emotional. And somebody may say, what are you talking about, Stephen? Everything I went through prepared me for the Adoration Project in Atlanta.
Yes.
Because that great was the project that produced, I co-produced it with Richard, and that was the song Total Praise. Mm-hmm. And after doing that record, everything exploded.
Yes. Oh my gosh.
It exploded wherein I was just getting called to do projects after projects after projects. Mm-hmm. I'll stop there. Of course, my career went on from there.
Right.
Let me flip and go back to the education part, because that's where I am now.
Yes.
Uh-huh. When I left Temple, when I left after my first year, because I left to go on the road with my music career. When I left, I remember this, a conversation with my mom, and my mom said to me, my mother was really upset that I was making the decision not to finish my undergrad at Temple University. Mm-hmm. And I remember her saying to me, promise me you'll finish. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. I told her, Mom, I'm gonna finish. Mm-hmm. And she said, promise me. Mm-hmm. And I did. And so after my father died, and I called Marvin and Carvin Winans and told them that I was going to stay home to be with my family and church, and I was going to just come off the road.
Right.
You know, that they understood, but that was quite a moment for me to walk through.
Yeah. And,
then I made the decision to do what I promised my mother to do. And I went back and finished my undergrad. Went on to Vermont to finish my master's. I have a master's in fine arts from Vermont College of Fine Arts. Mm-hmm. And I got a PhD. I have an honorary doctorate in sacred music.
Mm-hmm.
And an earned doctorate in research as well, in composition, orchestration, and creative art.
Mm-hmm.
And I was able to get involved with a program in Australia. So for the last, I don't know how many years, I've been going back and forth to Australia, and I do residency, PhD residency lectures and all of that, and in Australia. And the reason Australia worked well for me is that I would actually, you know, teach my schedule during the fall and the spring, and then the summer I would spend in Australia. And of course, like, it's winter time in Australia now. So
okay.
I would usually be in Australia during this time, because I would spend my summers in Australia and then come back in August and then start the school year. So that's how all of that happened. Do I sleep? Well, maybe not too much, but God has been good to me. I tell people, it's not that I'm that old. I'm just like a car that has a lot of mileage. You know, a car that you just drive all the time. So, so that's where I am now. I'm now the chair of the music department at Eastern University.
Yes.
I'm over the music and arts, fine arts division. I'm over the music department, dance, theater, and fine arts, which is, you know, graphic arts and all of that.
Wow.
I'm the first African American to be in that position. I'm saying that I often tell people, you know, that's what I am. That's the color of my skin. That's who I am, because Black Lives Matter. And then I also tell them, I said, but what you have to understand is that I also walk in the role of a pastor.
Yes.
So, all the students will tell you that, you know, I treat them the same. I require them to do what they're supposed to do.
Right.
Some of them say that I smile, but I'm hard because I want the best out of them.
Right.
Absolutely. But I know that the Lord opened up a door for me to be where I am, and that's to give him glory in everything that I do. So yeah. I condensed it because it's just so much. I probably only scratched the surface, but I wanted to get through that so we can, we can answer questions and we can move to the next place of this long interview.
It's okay. But isn't it amazing? And how important is it for us to have music to remain in the school system? You know, because that seems to be the first thing that is gone out of a lot of schools, where they will remove the music program. So children are not really playing instruments like they used to, you know. So how important is that? And that's something that we need to, you know, make sure that if it doesn't happen there or in the church, be able to give lessons or something for children. Because I think music is an integral part of life.
Music is. There's so many kind of studies about how music affects your mental capacity to be able to retain the repetitive. I mean, music really is, I should say, it can be the lifeline of a student development, of a student's development. And unfortunately, you know, I kind of get really bent out of shape because when they started cutting programs, you know, I'm like, y'all got to be crazy. What are you doing? You know, but I have to speak to this. Let me actually speak on two different areas. Almost all of your accomplished musicians have some kind of background in the church. Somewhere they've come through the church.
That's true.
And you can go from, you know, classical music all the way through every genre of music, you know, whether it's jazz or whatever, they've started somewhere in the church. That's so when parents stop taking children to church, all of that's tied in.
That's true.
And if you have a good music program at the church, you will have growth at your church. So that's really important. And the reason I say the church, because then that does point to, you know, the education system.
Yes.
I think that, you know, as time went on, our communities were too quiet. I think that once they took music out of the schools, as far as cutting back on the arts programs, that people should have bombarded Congress, went on strike, do everything, because, you know, taking music out of the schools was detrimental. Why?
Yes.
Because that was the expression for so many children.
Yes.
When I look at my career, I wouldn't have been able to be exposed to the music of the orchestra without touching those instruments. See,
that's true.
Like a basketball player. You know, you can have the most talented basketball player on your team, but if he doesn't touch the ball, he's no value to the team. So he has to touch it. Same thing when I look at music. A child has to touch the instrument. And it's a proven study. If I make an instrument available to a child, it's not only going to build their interest in music, but they'll develop. A child is like a sponge. And I don't believe that you should wait till a child is like, you know, 13, 14 years old. Of course, you can learn at any age, true. But there are studies when a child is hearing music at 2 and 3 years old. What happens if that child can, you know, be able to touch a piano or touch a drum or touch a bass, put it in their hands, and they will amaze you. There's also a study and it's proven that you can have a baby that's 2 years old, two or 3 years old, right? And then let them hear music. And I'm not just saying, you know, row, row, row your boat. No, I'm saying you can play Stravinsky for them, and you can play some of the jazz greats, Chick Corea. You can play those songs for them. Right? Let the child hear it at 2 and 3 years old, and let that be a part of their learning diet. Right? And you can even go further. If you are musically inclined, you can actually play a note on piano for a baby. Let them hear that note. Just let them hear that note. Three years old, they're listening to that note, and they start singing that note back.
That's right.
It's something in their development that they can almost hear that note and give it a comparison to a color.
Yes.
So it's easier to develop relative pitch or perfect pitch from the baby up, because now once they hear that tone and they sing that tone back to you and you start identifying, oh, that's an E.
Right.
That baby will know that's an E, and you'll be surprised that you'll hit that note and the baby is, and they'll say an E. By the time they get 4 years old, you hit that note and they'll say, ah, that's not an E. And you can be playing an E flat.
Right.
Why? Because it's something in their mind and their brain. Now, after we get a certain age as adults, that's a whole nother story.
That's another message, like they say.
So it is so important. And I know I answered that, kind of really went into depth with this.
Yes.
It is so important that we fight to put music back in the schools the way it should be.
Yes.
And then, you know, right now we know that our country is just going through this whole systemic issues that faces us. And, you know, I just don't want music to be brought back to the schools, but I want resources to be brought back to our community.
Yeah.
So, you know, when you look at the schools in suburbia, you know, they get the best instruments. You look at the inner city, you know, it's a fight for you to get access to those instruments.
Right.
You know, why can't we have timpanis and why can't we have harps in the inner city schools? Because unless you make that available to the students, they won't respect it. You have to be able to make sure that that's available. So what helped me was we lived above the church. You know, we lived on top of the church. Every day I could go downstairs and play on the piano and play on the organ because I had access to go in and play.
Right.
So the students were out playing basketball. Now I did, you know, start playing basketball, and I did have a nice game of basketball. I'll tell you that. Anyway, but I had that instrument available to me, and that helped the development. You know, and I was teasing a mother not too long ago. She'd asked me, she said, you know, how can I get my, you know, daughter to practice? You know, it seems like, you know, she's not practicing like I need to. I said, well, here's how you do it. Buy her a new keyboard and then tell her, don't play it.
Right. She's going to play it. That's true.
And she tried it and she said, Stephen, it worked. I said, well, here's what happened. You had it available for her.
Yeah.
And the reason, and then when you said that, you challenged her. And that pushed her to be able to find out what that keyboard can do.
Right.
And once she started touching it, once she started handling it and touching it and finding out that it could reward her, because now she can hear some sound and make little chords. And I said, then that helped her more than you ever would know. Now it's time to make sure that she gets an instructor that will be able to teach her and help her grow.
Absolutely. Great answer. Now I have a question here. Minister Ford, any new books on the horizon?
Well, I probably need to write a book about my life.
Your journey, that's for sure. That would be a memoir. That would be great.
Yeah, there's a lot. I mean, Jonathan DeVos asked me to write something for a project that he's working on, and it's actually on Facebook. If you tag on to Jonathan's Facebook page, you'll find it. But when I was writing it out, and I will tell you, I got emotional because I'm one that I don't really live in the past. So, of course, you can say how hard it was for you to say, okay, Steve, can we nail down a time for you to do this interview? I'm talking now about what I've done, but if you spend time with me, you will never hear me talk about it. I just don't. And
that's true.
It's because I believe that what God has allowed me to do in the past. See, I believe that's the problem for some people. They're still living in yesterday.
That's true. They are.
And they don't understand that yesterday prepares you for today and tomorrow, but you have to leave the concept of yesterday.
Right.
Okay. So if I lived only in yesterday, that means I would still be telling you about the Total Praise Express experience, which is a wonderful experience.
Right.
But if I got stuck in the Total Praise experience, I would never be a chairman of the music department now.
Wow.
Because I would still be stuck there. So right now for me, I'm already working into 2 and 3 years ahead now. That's where my head is. I'm actually already preparing or actually having things set for where what needs to be manifested 2 years from now. So I'm not thinking about that. That's why I had an issue, or I'm saying that's why I had challenges to try to remember all the things that I've done. Because I don't live there. Plus, you know, I give God the glory, and then, you know, his glory moves. So we got to go with the cloud. You got to move with the cloud.
Keep going. Now, Stephen Hurd, which I'm so excited to have him on here tonight, he said, with this landscape of our current day, where do you see music ministry going or progressing?
Oh, okay, that's a hot topic. All right, Stephen Hurd. I knew somebody was going to start it. This season is the best season for music ministry. First of all, COVID-19, and that's what we call it, the coronavirus. You know, I say this, we've named it. That's not God's name for it. And you know, I don't want to go down that road, but I will say it from this perspective. I feel that this is the time where God just allowed this to happen, and allowed it to happen for a reason, to get the attention of the church.
Yes.
And during this time of shut-in, time of quarantine, this is a time for preparation, as Stephen is asking. So this is a time that you're preparing for we're living in the next now, but how do you prepare that when you come out of quarantine, where do we go? Well, let's look at what has happened. We've now learned that you don't have to be in church for 5 and 6 hours to have an effective presentation of ministry.
That's right.
Because now people are realizing, you know what, we can do this online and we can do it in an hour. So it has forced everyone to just get into the Word of God and tell it. So now we're cutting off all the fluff.
Right.
What has it done for music? Well, now, if you notice, the choirs can't sing right now.
Right, right.
It's forced us to be able to use technology. And now I see a lot of choir productions, you know, video going up. But if you ask any singer that had to kind of lay their single track, first thing they will tell you, if they was honest with themselves, they say, ooh, I hated how I sounded. Oh, wow, I was out of key. I was a little out of pitch. Mm-hmm. Well, now it's isolated so you can hear what needs to be perfected in your skill.
That's right. Absolutely right.
Okay, so what's happening? This is a time for preparation for the church, for the music ministry.
Yeah.
Okay. To go back to school, get involved, understand the education part of music, the theory, find out what you're doing, why you're doing it. There are so many resources online to help singers know how to better take care of their voice, but actually how to sing better and what you should be singing about.
Right.
This time is also giving you time or the opportunity to be able to study the word of the Lord, so you'll know what you're singing about.
All right.
And it's preparing you to have a more effective ministry.
Yeah. Okay?
And if you notice, now it's also bringing out, I should say, you know, it's starting to show that it makes me think about sometimes in the choir, you would have somebody that's skating, which means, you know, I'm standing beside an alto and she know her part. So I'm not really, you know, I don't have to really learn my part too much, you know, because I'm leaning on her. Mm-hmm. It ain't no more leaning.
No.
It ain't no more leaning. And will we go to the next place as far as, you know, being able to do what we did before? I teach this concept, you know, people say, I'm going back to church. Then I would say, are you going back to what? What are you going back to?
Back to, yes.
No, no, you need to say, you know, what we're moving forward to and how effective our ministry will be, how effective our music will be, how effective our anointing will be, because the anointing destroys the yoke, okay? And so now it's challenging everyone in music ministry to get prepared that you'll be able to present an anointed ministry. I actually was sharing something, Stephen heard when we was having a little conversation. And when I speak of our worship, people might say, okay, what is the real, or what do you think is, what is your spin on what's going on, Stephen?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you notice from the CDC reports, singing. That's the issue with spraying. So the spittle, the spraying is coming out when you're singing, right? Mm-hmm. So my question is, could it be that there was contamination in our singing? God just says, you know what, I've got to shut it down because the spittle that you're spewing out is contaminating my worship.
Wow.
So what I need you to do is get quarantined so we can sanctify your heart. So what comes out of your mouth will be, okay, let me stop.
No, go on. That's right. What comes out of your mouth.
What comes out of your mouth will now be a sweet smelling savor to me. So I view that this time is a time of preparation. It reminds me, I've heard some pastors make reference to this, and this is so true. You know, quarantine is nothing new to God. And that, as a matter of fact, the whole coronavirus, this didn't come to God by surprise.
Yes.
It didn't come to God by surprise. So quarantine, when you check the Bible, Noah was put in quarantine. Yeah, why? Because he put him in the ark. So that means that he was preparing for the next season, okay, where the world was going to.
Yes.
Everything was renewed. So that's what he's done when we look at the fact of what is the job of the music ministry and where do we go from here? Take this time. Don't blow this time. Don't blow this time.
Yes, absolutely. Don't blow it. And what can you share? There are many musicians that are no longer working. Some churches can't afford to continue to pay them. and they're not really, they're having service, but people are not really giving in some churches like they used to. What can you share to musicians? I know of several that are, you know, not working right now. What could you share to them to encourage them, or, you know, give them something that will, you know, because I know a lot of times we hear multiple streams of income. You do need that. And I think that this is an opportune time for people to find some other sort or way to make an income, musicians I'm referring to. So what can you share and say to musicians that are dealing with this at this time, with this pandemic?
Let me come from this perspective. The scripture says every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights. Okay, so it's dealing with the fact that when God gives a gift to you, he gives it perfect. When he gives the gift of music, he gives it perfect to an imperfect vessel, okay? Which means that all of our life that we're working, we are working to develop ourselves to get up to the level of the gift. Mm-hmm. Now, what are you saying, Ford? I'm also saying that when he gives you the gift, when he touches an individual and gives them the gift of music, mm-hmm. there's other gifts that comes along with music. Mm-hmm. Many times the enemy don't want you to know that.
That's true.
So what am I speaking of? Mm-hmm. If you check in, I believe Ezra, check in First Chronicles, check in First Kings. It talks about the Levites, and it also talks about, especially in First Kings, it talks about when the Levites were called into service. Mm-hmm. It talks about the timbers that were used for mm-hmm. the temple.
Yeah.
So when you start checking the names of the workers, the carpenters, some of them were the same names of the musicians. Oh, mm-hmm. which means that they not only had the gift of music, but they had other gifts, because it was the hands of the Levites that did mm-hmm. the building. It was the hands of the Levites. So what are you saying for it? I'm saying that every musician has more than one gift. Yeah. As a matter of fact, I teach this concept that every musician can really play every instrument. You might have a concentrated instrument, but if you play bass, you can play drums. If you play drums, you can play piano. If you play piano, you can play organ. If you play organ, you can play trumpet. You can play, you know. What am I saying? Why am I saying that? Well, the gift of music is the gift to minister music. You have a concentration because, you know, if I'm a guitar player, that was my choice, but I can play other instruments. Now let me also connect that to fill out this answer. So the next part of that is, if you're a musician, that means you also will be able to be a great accountant. You can be a wonderful in technology. Mm-hmm. You could be wonderful in understanding business principles, okay? Why do you say that? Because it's all wrapped up in the gift. It's always in the bubble, it's in the bundle. So when God gives the gift, he gives you a package. And as you know, when you get a gift, you know, somebody gives you a box for your birthday and mm-hmm. it's wrapped, you know, we open it up, we throw away the wrapper, we throw away the, you know, the peanut stuff inside. No, that's all part of your gift. You tan it up and throwing it away. So what I'm saying, okay, God gives you the gift of music, but then he gives you all these other wrappings that incorporate and roll around, engulf the gift. Mm-hmm. Now, how do I tie that into a musician being encouraged? And what do you do during this time? Well, what you have to do, first of all, if you're working, if you understand, let me go technical. If you understand Logic or Pro Tools, yes, or GarageBand or any of the software packages, okay, mm-hmm. take that same skill. You can go online and get a trial version of Final Cut Pro, which is a video program.
Yeah.
You already have the skill to understand music.
Right.
So now let's put that same skill and challenge that same skill. Just like if I give you any instrument, you can play it. All you need is time with it. Take mm-hmm. that same skill and mm-hmm. develop a skill of video editing. Why? Because there's so many church choirs right now that's needing to have projects done, and it's overwhelming your video, the people that do video video ministry, the video departments, it's overwhelming. So you need help. Now, I've taken that same ability to understand how to do a music song or something musically, mm-hmm. and I'm taking it into understanding the technology and using the technology to open up income stream for me to be able to do that. Okay, that's one thing. We're just talking about the technology part of it. Mm-hmm. The other part of it is being able to be a better steward of your time.
Yeah.
Now, let me turn the corner and kind of come from a Levitical priest standpoint.
Okay.
Stephen Hurd calls me the pastor of music. So let me talk to the musicians from a pastoral standpoint.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to love you up because, you know, it's always good to chastise and then love and then chastise and love. So I'm going to love you first and say that I love all musicians because I'm a musician first.
Absolutely. Right.
Let me share this. I remember there are so many musicians that call me Uncle Steve or Uncle Pops.
Yeah.
And those that would talk to me before they go on tour. This was way before the pandemic.
Yes.
I would always tell them one thing. And those that is on this, you know, if they're out there, they can chime in.
Yeah.
I'd say, learn how to live off your per diem.
Mm.
Don't touch your salary.
Mm-hmm.
Learn how to live off your per diem, which means if I'm going to each, we're doing concerts in different towns or whatever,
right.
I ain't gonna be going out and eating with everybody and buying Jordan sneaks and all this other stuff. Or I'm not gonna do that. I'm not gonna be going to get a designer, nothing. I'm gonna learn how to live off my per diem, which means, okay, I'm learning how to live frugally. I'm learning to do that, and then learn how to save. So my thing is, now you should be able to go on tour and never touch your salary, just live off your per diem. Mm-hmm. Is it a sacrifice? It's only a sacrifice the first week, because once your body gets used to not eating every night, you learn how to drink a glass of water and go to bed, because you're going to gain weight at night anyway. Okay, that's a whole other stuff. All right. Okay, so now you've learned how to live requiring less.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Don't get into this thing of showing. I got to just show everybody what. No. Don't learn how to live off of less. Okay.
Yes. Then,
here's another thing.
Mm-hmm.
I used to always wonder, you know, what was the mindset of musicians? If you're working, you're playing for rehearsal on Thursday night.
Mm-hmm.
You have a rehearsal on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're playing for maybe two services on Sunday.
Right.
Then my question is, so why are you in bed till 2 o'clock in the afternoon on Monday morning?
Mm.
What are you doing the rest of your week?
That
you couldn't get into some kind of business program to understand that I need to be able to build myself away from music. My dad taught me this when I was young. He said it's a poor, and everybody forgive how I'm going to say this because this is how he gave it to me. Mm-hmm. He said it's a poor rat that only have one hole.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, which means I only got one. If the cat get after you, you only got one hole to run into to hide.
Right.
So you have to think of other ways of creating income streams. If you're staying up all night playing a video game and you haven't understood that I would rather you learn how to write the program for the video game, or I would rather you learn how to compose the music for the video game, become a music composer, a video game composer.
Mm-hmm.
So now you can be able to utilize your music skill
mm-hmm.
and take you a whole nother way. So that's one of the things I'll say. You have to be creative. You have to start saying, okay, what other gifts and talents do I have?
Yeah.
And how can I expand on those gifts and talents?
Mm-hmm.
So I encourage musicians to don't be lazy. Take this time, get out there. You know, nobody's just going to come and just hand you something. And when I talk about my career, you know, one part I have to always let people know is that, yes, doors opened, but I worked hard. I worked hard before the doors opened. I worked hard to learn how to write charts and write scores mm-hmm. because one of the reasons I was hired on the spot for the wine is that I was able to write charts. I was able to, we did a lot of the Arsenio Hall projects that mm-hmm. the whole band couldn't travel to. That was all written out. I wrote all those charts. They read that music.
Really?
Okay. Wow. So all of Richard's sessions, all the musicians team that will tell you, I write charts out for everything.
Really?
Why?
Wow.
Because it legitimizes what you do
mm-hmm.
and it takes you to the next place as far as professionalism.
Mm-hmm.
If a musician goes through this pandemic and you were not reading and you come out of this pandemic and you still don't read, then I challenge you to say, how dare you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, let me also talk about this other part, because we talk to musicians, but many times we don't talk to the pastors and to church yeah. administration.
Mm-hmm.
The pay protection programs, that was designed to be able to pay staff while we're going through this pandemic. I think that many churches have to really step up their game with understanding that there's a business part of it as well, because mm-hmm. if that musician, and it's not only a musician, but anybody that's working for the church, okay,
right.
there were provisions that the government offered, which means that there should have been something in place to be able to take care of, because you know, we try to put the musicians in one category and then try to put the other workers in another category.
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't the Levitical order. They all were considered Levites, even though they did different jobs. So
right.
that means that when it came time for the disbursement of funds, mm-hmm. Tithing in the whole system, that they were all included. So I think, you know, when we really talk about how do we prepare not only, you know, for musicians to have income, then we also need to prepare, you know, pastors and administrators
mm-hmm.
to understand that you have responsibility as well. I'm gonna stop. I want to open up for our questions.
That's okay. This is good. This is really, really good. Really good. David Frazier, the songwriter, he says, what road gospel band was your favorite to work with?
Oh. Wow. Well, that's kind of a tough question, because each of the bands had a different character and a different purpose.
Mm-hmm.
You can have, and the most important part is how they gel together and how they were able to coexist together. Because you can have some talented musicians and talented singers, but you put them together in a group and it just don't work because their spirits don't connect.
That makes, yes.
So with that said, I would have to talk about each of the bands individually and what they did. I just say, when I first started with Richard, we had a real small band. It was just Jeff Davis, myself, and Tim Lindsay. the late Tim Lindsay, late Jeff, they both are, you know, resting with the Lord now. Mm-hmm. In that time, they just really understood Richard at that time.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, if we move to compare what we did for the Smallwood Singers and to compare that to Visions Band,
mm-hmm.
two different sounds, two different approaches. Why? Because it was a different Richard. Richard yeah. was different in the 1990s than Richard was in the 1970s.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So mm-hmm. that meant that what we were playing in the 80s and, you know, for the Smallwood Singers
mm-hmm.
was a different approach. So for me to try to compare him, you know, I do understand what he's saying as far as who I enjoy to be with. I must say I had to adapt to where I was. Mm-hmm. Now, when I look at the Winans Band, I will say that the core of our band wasn't me. I might have been the musical director, but I was not the core of the band. Mm-hmm. The core of the band was Dana Davis.
Okay.
Dana Davis was the drummer. But Dana mm-hmm. Davis actually started with the Winans. He was like a little boy almost.
Mm-hmm.
But Dana Davis knew all the material backward and forward, and he was a human metronome, mm-hmm. which means that he could set the tempo and it would not move. So when I look at that band, at that time, Dana Davis, Kern Bradley, Skip Pruitt, Benji Love played with us, and Lafayette Carthon. That they brought a whole nother approach to music. And what I will say is that if you follow my career, Richard is a whole nother side of music expression. The Winans was a whole nother side. Yeah. So my brain had to do transformation to be able to be a music. And there was a certain time that I was actually going out with Richard and then going out with the wine. So, you know, yeah. I had to wear different hats and different expressions.
Yes.
For the Winans era, I would say that band really impressed me. But if I want to just answer your question and not be political, because I'm not being political, I'm just trying to explain, you know, come from it from another standpoint. Mm. I would say my covenant relationship. Now, that's mm-hmm. another word. That means now I've changed from just the professional job that we were called to do. Mm-hmm. And now I went into an anointed place of the covenant relationship.
Right.
Then I would have to say Mark Walker. Tony Walker.
Tony, yes.
Jeff Davis, mm-hmm. Jonathan DeBose, and mm-hmm. Ryan Pugh. That was Richard's band. But what made that different for me is at that time in my career, Jeff Davis, Jonathan, and the core of that was Jeff Davis, Jonathan, and Tony. We grew together mm-hmm. because we come through so many things together.
Yeah.
And then that became my core band, you know, such that we didn't have to play music. We prayed together. We fast together. We called mm-hmm. on the name of the Lord together. Yeah. We went to conferences where we didn't play music. We sat in Detroit at Straight Gate each year. Mm-hmm. We would have Bishop Merritt would have conferences.
Mm-hmm.
We would just lay before the Lord together. And
yes.
And then I would have to say the band in Baltimore, because I'm also in Baltimore with CRL, Church of the Redeemed of the Lord, Bishop Stokes in Baltimore,
yeah.
Kenny Shelton, that team, Marvin Thompson. Of course, Marvin and I have gone back years. Trombone, Mohorns. But Danny, Kenny, Danny, Josh, Nick, that's the band in Baltimore. Mm-hmm. And we're really connected. So,
Wow.
But one thing I will say, to also kind of wrap up my answer to David, I like to play and minister with musicians who have a heart for God, and they love the word of the Lord more than they love music.
Wow.
And everyone that I've just talked about, that's how they carry themselves.
Yes. That's very important. It's very important. Now, Roberto has a question, and he wanted to know, what is your dissertation topic?
Okay. Yes. Now they're digging deep, right? My dissertation, I'm talking about the influence of Western European art on gospel, on African-American gospel music. So the influences that have been somewhat hybrided from European, Western European art music, okay? Mm-hmm. So it's actually dealing with the fact that I tell people that when you, when I just boil down all the common denominators to what I really am, I tell them I ain't nothing but a church musician. Okay. Why am I saying that? Well, I also support it by saying that gospel is really Baroque. Gospel music is the Baroque music of this era. What does that mean? Well, the Baroque era, okay, we talk about, now we talk about the eras of music. We're talking about the classical period, the Renaissance period. We're talking about the medieval period and how that all falls into place. Well, in the Baroque period, you had so many musicians, but you had one musician that kind of stands out, and his name was Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach.
That's right.
But he was a church musician.
Yeah.
Okay, so it amazes me. We build all these classical things, and, you know, but they came out of the church because he was a church musician.
Yeah.
And that's why I say the musicians of the church, but just think about today.
Okay?
We actually dominate R&B, pop, country, all of that, right?
Right.
What am I saying? That these are musicians that come out of the church. All right. And but let me say this also. I gotta say this, you know, because many times, you know, church people, or I should say some people in church, thumb their noses up at the musicians. Because they say y'all came out of church and y'all playing for everything. And I say, no. You have to understand this. They might be playing outside of the church. They didn't come out of the church.
Right. Church is with them.
The church is in them. So if y'all did y'all job, the church would be in them. And no matter where they go, I have musicians that work with secular artists all over the world. Call me Uncle Steve, and they check in. It's amazing how they're checking in. They're sending me texts to let me know where they are. They'll send me texts to say, pray for me. They'll say, Uncle Steve, when they just send me a text and just say, Uncle Steve, I say, okay, all right, straighten out, straighten up. But that's because I love them, and I understand the call on their lives because many of them are having a chance to witness to people that we would never touch.
That's true. That's absolutely right.
And people that would never hear you. Okay, so in order for you to hear me, that means that, first of all, I have to have a relationship with you. You have to trust me.
Right.
And there's been a lot of artists that I've worked with. And amazingly, you know, I'll work with them and they know what I'm about. And mm-hmm. then they'll just say something to me to say, you know, Steve, can you pray for me? Which means that they saw something in my life that they would be able to trust the prayer, my prayer life.
Yes. So
all the musicians, you know, please develop a prayer life. This is a good time for you to start developing one. You yes, know, now that you closed up, I believe the Lord is probably hearing some prayers that he never heard before. Lord, I need your help. God, I got a bill coming. Lord, okay.
That's right. Now, Steve, before we go, I have another question for you. And the importance or how to prepare for a recording.
Oh, okay. Well, what you need to do, first of all, there's so many components, and we may not even have time to finish this, so maybe mm-hmm. I'll just have to commit to come back and do another one.
Yeah.
I would have to ask the question. We would have to have a conversation back and forth as far as to answer the question appropriately, so I'll just try to condense it. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is I would have to ask what kind of recording, because there's so many different preparations for the recording. So whether it's going to be a live recording, whether it's going to be a studio recording, mm-hmm. Whether it's going to be an instrumental recording, whether it's going to be a choir recording, a small group recording, mm-hmm. whether it's going to be a worship recording, you know, what would be the intent of the recording. However, mm-hmm. there are some things that you still have to think about. And, you know, just like anything, first of all, in classical music or in any type of music, the key to being able to be successful is practice, which means you got to practice. You got to put that hard time in. You got to practice. You got to practice. Mm-hmm. So, and that's part of the preparation. Mm-hmm. So the artist has to be able to get their performance up to a level, first of all, that's worthy of a consumer mm-hmm. Buying your product. So don't think you're gonna make a recording and you singing all out of tune and everything else and mm-hmm. and somebody gonna buy your recording. No. You got to do some work before you start preparing for the recording. So make sure that you start preparing. Mm-hmm. Get some great material. So mm-hmm. make sure that the songs that you're gathering, that, you know, they have a theme or something, like, in other words, songs, and you're going to say something on the recording. So you're practicing, getting ready for it. Get the proper material for mm-hmm. it.
Right.
Okay, if it's going to be a choir record, mm-hmm. then you start teaching the material. And that process, to me, is the most laboring, because sometimes you can have a song that sounds really good in its infancy, but after you start teaching it, then you might have to start tweaking it and say, that might not work, this worked. Yeah. Okay, right. So then you have your song list. You get your song list together. Mm-hmm. Okay. But within that process, I always recommend, you know, talking to a producer, because, you know, if you start the conversation with the producer early, okay, uh-huh. you will cut out a lot of headaches and mistakes, especially if you have no experience in recording, because mm-hmm. the producer will be able to help steer you in the things that you should not do. Okay, then you're going to deal with two elements. You know, getting your band together, who's going to be your band director, who's going to be over that, yeah. who's going to do your arrangements, mm-hmm. okay? Because mm-hmm. I also must let you know that a person that's doing the arrangements and a person that's writing your song, they can be the same person, mm-hmm. okay? But there are some times when you have a person who writes the song, but they need an arranger to arrange the song. So you want to get that out the way. Uh-huh. Then start thinking about if it's going to be a live recording, then where your venue is going to be, where it's going to be, who's going to do the recording, what engineer, talking to your engineers to find out what their needs are, okay? And then once you gather all that information with the producer, then you want to see what kind of budget you're dealing with, all right?
Yeah.
And put that aside to make sure that you be able to afford, you know, what your wishes are.
Right.
Yes. Then go forward into the production. So I would say, you know, in that order, you know, you're going to get yourself ready, first of all.
Mm-hmm.
Get songs written and arranged.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're going to, you know, get a producer to help you walk through those processes.
Mm-hmm.
And that producer then takes on the role of getting the right engineers, getting the right musicians in place, getting the right recording engineer, then getting the right mix engineer, then getting the right mastering engineer. Now, in this day and time, you have some people that try to, that say that they're jack of all trades. They're going to record, mix, master everything.
Yeah.
Well, technology allows you to do that in some cases, but I come from the school that, you know, I try to go to who does what the best, especially when it comes to mixing and mastering, which means if I'm living really close to a project, I want another set of ears to hear what's going on. Yeah. Then after that person mixes it, then I'm going to send it to a person who can master it, because now I have more ears listening to what it sounds like, to be able to bring it to its best ending. So so it's a lot of things. And I know I had to kind of answer that in so many segments, because that was a hard question and in order for me to really deal with it. So that's why you have to have that one-on-one conversation that I can find out the specific needs of the individual.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, Steve, I thank you so much for being here tonight.
Well, thank you. You know, let me jump in real quick. I got to say something, because I heard, you know, you made an announcement to who's going to be on coming up. You said some names of friends of mine, Bill Jolly from Philadelphia. I got to tell this. These are things that people probably never knew. Bill Jolly and I, we've been, you know, brothers and friends for a long, long time. And hopefully this will also encourage musicians. I have a saying that I think I might have said it to you in a text or email. I live in the next. In other words, I don't stay in the past. I live in the present and the next, which means I want to always plan for what's going on next and how to be prepared for it, right? Which means I can go back, and I'm going to tie Bill Jolly into this, but let me set it up. Not only did I learn how to play the Hammond organ, but I brought schematics to learn everything about the organ, so I can learn the tubes of the organ.
Yeah,
you know, the tone bars, the generators. Why? Because on the road, one of the things that I was able to, I should say, bolster my worth is that if something went down, I was able to fix it or know how to have it fixed. So we're traveling, I made sure that I had it, you know, the correct things. I learned how to, the mechanics of what makes the synthesizer work.
Yeah.
Now, I'm saying that to say this, that was way back in the 70s. When we got into the 80s, I needed to get ahead of the curve. So how do I do that? Bill Jolly and I had a great friendship. And Bill Jolly had an instrument called the emulator. Now, that instrument was before its time. It was a sampler. It was, and if anybody ever remember seeing me, I think on the Oprah Winfrey show, playing for the Winans, I'm playing this big gray keyboard. It looks gray.
Yeah.
It was an emulator. Okay. And I used to travel with that emulator. Well, Bill Jolly turned me onto it when it was first released. What the emulator was back in the day was a sampler, which means I was able to sample vocals. So people don't know what I did in my performances. I used the emulator. I learned everything about it. And I did what we call keyboard mapping, which means throughout the keyboard, each octave, I programmed it. So each octave would have different sounds,
mm-hmm.
and different triggers. If you ever go back and listen to live at Carnegie Hall with the Winans,
mm-hmm.
there was no overdubs on that record.
Really?
That was what we did that night. I didn't have to go in and clean up anything. That was one time with no mistakes. Everything was done. We went in the studio to just check everything. No cleanups.
Wow, amazing.
But you will hear horns, you will hear strings, you will yep. hear synth. And it was, the band was only myself, Skip Pruitt, mm-hmm. Jump Dana Davis, I think it was George Bell on guitar, I think. And it might've been Lafayette or Benji on keys.
Mm-hmm.
And everything else you heard was me.
Really?
And I was wondering, okay, how is he doing what he's doing? Mm-hmm. Well, one octave, I had all my horn sounds. I had mm-hmm. my baritone sax, my tenor sax. I mapped it across my keyboard. Now I'm telling my secrets, right? I mapped it across my keyboard. So I have my trumpets, and just like I'm playing in a section,
yeah.
but I had the notes such that when I play it, it would sound how a horn section would sound.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then
amazing.
The next couple of octaves, I would have some of the pad sounds that I needed. Now this is all within this unit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then today, a lot of musicians use what we call stems, where you have the track playing
yeah.
and you have some of the vocals just to help, you know, booster the vocals.
Mm-hmm.
I was doing that in the 80s through the emulator. Because one of my octaves, I took the brothers into the studio, Carvin and Ron, and laid down all the vocals and put it in floppy disk.
Yes.
And wow. I did that because we were traveling so much that they were getting vocal exhaustion. And with their steps and moving everything, people didn't know that I'm actually playing.
Right. Their vocals.
Parts of it. They're singing.
Amazing.
But that just gave me some support.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why am I connecting Bill Jolly to that? It was Bill Jolly that turned me onto the instrument. But then I had to have the initiative to take it beyond technology
mm-hmm.
to go to the next place. And I'm saying that to encourage the musicians of today.
Mm-hmm.
If you think that after this pandemic, you're going to come back using what you used yesterday, you already defeated.
Mm-hmm.
You need to think ahead and say, how can I change what I do? How can I bring it up to date? What do I need to do? Am I going to just stick at what used to work? Or am I going to take a position that I'm going to learn everything about music? I'm going to learn about writing. I'm going to learn about composing.
Yeah.
I'm going to learn about writing, putting it all together.
Mm-hmm.
I will also encourage you, as we wrap this up, I work with one of the mentors that I highly, highly respect and loved. His name was James Mack, and his name really may not ring any bell, but mm-hmm. James Mack is out of Chicago. He was an orchestrator. And I did work with him when I did work for the Essence Awards. I did a lot of, you know, orchestration for some of the Essence Awards stuff. But James was my mentor, and James Mack said this to me. He said, Steve, he says, I'll tell you this. He said, you have to learn how to write charts, and you learn how to, you need to be proficient at it. He said, because there will be a day that you're doing so much music that you won't be able to remember it. You
yeah.
won't be able to remember it. He said,
yeah.
have a book, write it down.
Yeah.
He said, that way you can be called on any gig to work for anybody at the drop of the hat. And I listened to him.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I was able to go from artist to artist to artist, because what people didn't know is that I did have a book that I would write down all. Some days I would just take a time on a Saturday and listen to a record and chart out the record and have it in my book.
Wow.
Because I never knew when somebody might call and say, you know what,
mm-hmm.
you know, my is sick. Are you able to come and do my show? We got mm-hmm. a show. And Steve, can I fly you in? And I used to get they used to fly me in to MD tapings, TV tapings, whatever, just wow. because I had that. So now I have it in my iPad where I just have, if, you know, and I don't play that much anymore. I let all the young guys do that. But if I ever have to do it and they say, Steve, you know, we need you to sit in, I say, okay, what you doing? And they call a song. If I need to, you know, the musicians in Baltimore will tell you, I'll just dial it up on my iPad and I'll just sit and play with them without rehearsal. Why?
Wow. 'Cause I'll play it out. Oh my gosh. That is amazing. Amazing. This has been a challenging night. Very inspirational. That's what a lot of people are saying. And they say you have to come back. As we're closing, I want to really thank everyone for participating and coming on and being a part and still being with us. I really have enjoyed this night for your wisdom and your expertise. You definitely have to write your book. Your journey is tremendous, tremendous. There'll never be another person like Stephen Ford. And I thank you so much. You've always been the same and sharing. And it's just a bunch of, and someone else said that wisdom, a lot of wisdom. I want to ask you for your, I want us to be a blessing to him. He hasn't asked me for anything. He has not charged me a fee or anything. But I want us to be a blessing to him tonight. Steve, I need your you have a Cash App?
I do, but I don't know what it is. But I'll do but here's what I will do. Okay. Let me give you my email address.
Okay.
Info
mm-hmm.
at sfordmusic.com. Info. It's INFO. If you can share that with everyone, I want to do two things. Give them your Cash App. And if I've blessed you tonight, I want you to bless my sister.
Oh.
Okay.
I want you
to bless my sister. I'm going to actually seed into your ministry. So mm-hmm. I'll have my wife send you something. I think people need to understand that we need to support each other and build each other. And that's why I came on here tonight.
Yeah,
I wanted to be able to build what you're doing. So let's do that. I also, I'm giving you everybody my, if you can give them my email is, I've been led to do this. I started an institute and mm-hmm. I put it on hiatus to go back and finish my doctorate.
Mm-hmm.
I do want to be able to, and we and I'll just let the Lord kind of work through this. Mm-hmm. I'm just being led to maybe I can just have maybe a one-day workshop, like an hour masterclass, and mm-hmm. it will probably be a fee or something.
Yeah.
That those that are interested, that I will go through some of the elements of music, or you have the address, mm-hmm. email me and tell me what you would like. Yeah, let's do that. Tell me what you would like it to be. And because we can talk all day about what a person should do. Oh, you should invest. You should do this. You should right. have, you know, better streams. I'm mm-hmm. telling musicians that. But if I'm not showing you what it is, and I'm not walking you through it is mm-hmm. through what you should do, I'm not helping you at all. If anything, I might just be aggravating you because mm-hmm. I'm giving you information, but I'm not showing you how mm-hmm. to get there. And so. If we can do that, that would be a blessing. But yeah. everyone that's listening, I want you to seed into my sister, Cindy. No, I didn't charge her a fee. We didn't talk about money. I'm mm-hmm. not charging your fee, but I am challenging everybody to bless her because I know your heart. I know you wasn't expecting this.
No.
But I want the Lord to... There's been some prayers that you've been coming before the Lord. And I will say to you that God has not forgotten you.
Mm.
He hasn't forgotten you. You know, God will never let you outdo him. So your worship to him comes up to him as a memorial. And, you know, you've been through some things. And I'm not saying this, you know, sometimes people speak prophetically, but they're just speaking word of knowledge. They, you know, right. I'm not trying to get all deep like that, but right. I just, want you to understand that what you're doing is a good thing. What you're doing is a good platform. And mm-hmm. I believe that, you know, we want to be a blessing to you so you can be a blessing to someone else. So right. if you can do that, I will say this to your audience. Of course, this was a tender time for me. My brother Andrew went home to meet the Lord a year ago. I will say, lift my family up in prayer. You know, my family's quiet. So, you know, just like me, we never talk publicly about the things we've done. Mm-hmm. We're PKs. So if you've been a PK, you know, there's some things that PKs go through that nobody else can.
That's right.
But, you know, my sisters, my niece and nephew, you know, lift us and mention us in prayer. Now, sometimes, you know, when you say that to people, you know, I don't tell everybody to pray for me because some people pray for you, some people pray against you.
Yes.
You know, but as I want you to be blessed, anybody that knows me know that I'm about family and family means the world to me.
Yeah.
I believe that when my mother and father left here, they left here knowing that if anything, Steve is going to fight and take care of family.
His family.
And that's what I'm about. So lift this. Sydney, I love you. Thank you so very much.
And I thank you so much for your time and even your wife, give her my love as well. So I know sure. some time from her. When will you be going back to Australia?
Well, because of the shutdown, we don't know. Australia has actually had to backstep a little bit. You know, they had opened up and now they're kind of stepping back with the COVID-19. So I would probably say in the spring, late spring, I'll probably go back. Mm-hmm. I won't be shy. They would love for me to relocate there, but,
really?
I don't believe the Lord is saying that.
Right.
No, he's not saying that. Right now, I do, you know, let everyone know that Eastern University is where I am. And, yes. you know, if you're thinking of an undergrad degree in music, or if you need to get in through music and go somewhere else with it, it's not too late to get into the next semester. So, if that's the case, you know, you can apply and I am in charge of the department. So, you know, auditions and all that come through me. And I will say that, you know, I've had individuals that have auditioned and they were surprised, you know, that they made it into the program. Mm-hmm. And so if the Lord is leading you that way, undergrad degree is great. Moving into your master's degree, it does open up a lot of doors for you. It may take time for some people, but just understand, you know, it's good to be prepared.
It is.
Paul sat at the feet of Gamaliel, so it lets you understand in the Bible, Paul had his papers. Okay, now just stop right there. Mm-hmm. Paul had his papers, so I push education. Mm-hmm. It's the most important thing, and I'm so happy that the Lord took me that way because I didn't want to just only depend on the church. That's a whole nother evening that we can talk about.
Yeah.
So I set it up so I can go into education and can set up retirement, investment, all that set up for what I do. Mm-hmm. Every musician should understand that concept.
Yes, absolutely. You know, Dennis Atkinson is on here. He's been on.
Dennis. Dennis was actually my private student as well as came through my program at Eastern. Talented orchestrator. Yes. Dennis Atkinson. Yeah.
Yes, phenomenal. But we're going to say goodnight to everyone and thank you so much for joining. And I pray that you'll be back on tomorrow night hearing from the prophets. I have three prophets that's going to prophesy on tomorrow night, as well as let us know what the direction the church is headed and also individuals are headed. And I'm looking forward to that night. They are three powerful men and women of God. So please stay tuned tomorrow night at 8 o'clock. And don't forget also to join me on Thursday night with my good friend, Bill Jolly and Henry McMillan, and looking forward to that. And Steve, thank you again. And next year, maybe you have your book out or whatever. You do have a book out now. Can you tell us the name of your book?
The name of my book is called, Is Your Music Department Ministry or Misery? Yeah, the title alone kind of spells it. Is it Ministry or Misery?
Misery.
I got it somewhere around here. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Is it Music Department Ministry or Misery? Yeah, okay. I was looking to see if I had it. But yeah, so you could, my website is under construction, but you can visit the website s4music.com and you can purchase the book there as well as, you know, contact us through email and let us know if you would be interested in me just doing kind of a master class and or either getting to a music program that would be helpful to you online. And mm-hmm. I would consider, you know, working that out before the semester starts. Saying that because I'm on your program. I want to give that opportunity to your listeners. Okay.
When does your semester start?
August 24th.
Oh, okay.
All August 24th. And for those that might be interested in auditioning to Eastern, you know, we're still open for auditions because we can do virtual auditions, which means, you know, it'll just be you and me and maybe another professor, and I can check out what you're doing, whether you're singing bad or singing good.
Right.
Whether you're playing bad or playing good. But know that, you know, we're there to build, and I'm building the department. I'll say this and I'll stop. Anthony Walker is now on faculty at Eastern. Yeah. I was able to bring him in.
Yeah.
Phenomenal musician, phenomenal teacher. The students love him. He's just incredible. He's my covenant brother.
Yeah.
We've been together for a long time. Of course, he was at Deliverance with you. Yeah. And
he speaks well.
He's my heart, you know, with the Simpsons there and, you know, doing that time. So Anthony's there. Dr. Carla Scott, she's out of Maryland. She is over my contemporary vocal program. She's incredible. And I have her there not only because she's just an awesome teacher, but she understands the African-American voice as far as knowing how to connect gospel into classical, into, in other words, to have a better understanding of that. I have Professor Perry Briceman is there. Nimrod Speaks, who is an incredible bassist.
He's on here. He says to tell you hello.
Nimrod, yo. Okay. So what I'm actually doing is, you know, I want to create an environment for our community. Eastern is, you know, I don't have to sell Eastern. Eastern has its reputation. It's a great Christian school. But I think now that I'm kind of really putting the word out to let people know where we are, you know, to let pastors know where we are. We have a worship arts major now. And that's designed, a contemporary major, you know. Nimrod is over our jazz program. Jazz band. He has the jazz ensemble, and he also teaches American popular history.
Really?
Wow. Carla, Dr. Scott is teaching social justice and the arts. As you can see, I'm bringing in those that understand the Lord. Then I must say, I see the picture there. I am so happy to announce that my sister, the Reverend Dr. Michelle Ford, who is my pastor. She's just joined the faculty at Eastern. She will be teaching at Eastern starting this fall. And so you're going to have brother and sister teaching at the university together. That's you know, I'm just so excited to have my sister there. And for those that's been following, you know, her ministry at Serenity, she ain't no joke. She ain't no joke. You know, and I keep on saying that I'll say this and then stop, but I got to say this because I was connected to my father. I was the minstrel for my father.
Right.
I'd be able to play the song before my father sang. In other words, the Lord had anointed me that my father could stand up and I can start playing the song that he had in his spirit to sing. I felt him. I felt his rhythm. I felt when he didn't feel good, I knew how to play something that would encourage his heart, you know, seed back into him after he preached. And I've been so blessed because that same spirit and connection that I have with my father, I now have with my sister.
Yes.
Well, and it's a blessing for me because I feel that, you know, my father and mother passed before I can get to the age that I could do what the Bible says. In other words, take care of your parents when they get older. Mm-hmm. And so the phenomenal thing that God has done is that he's allowing me to take care of my parents. How?
Through your sister.
Michelle is my dad. Mm-hmm. Dolly is my mom. Mm-hmm. So you got it. You follow me, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm able to take care of, you know, mm-hmm. So my sister's at Eastern University, y'all. Y'all gotta lift us up. You know, we doing something for the kingdom.
Yes, and I'm going to constantly advertise that too. I'm going to announce it on my shows so that people will know. And I'm trying to get Michelle on here too for an interview. It's coming.
It's coming.
Yeah, but I'm going to have her on here. And Nimrod Speaks will be one of my guests in August, along with my nephew and some other phenomenal musicians. And that's going to be in August. And Nimrod, he's going to be one of my guests too. So I'm looking forward. And I didn't know all of that. I knew some of it, but I wasn't aware of all of it, him teaching at the university. So I'm looking forward to talking with him. My cousin is on, Reverend Richard Norris II. He's on. Oscar Payne, you remember Oscar?
Yes.
He's here.
Hello, Oscar. Yeah.
Yes, Bill Smith. It's a number of musicians. Oh my gosh, that's been on tonight. And I just thank God again, Stephen Hurd, because I've been trying to reach him and I'm going to have him on here. He and Michelle, those are two guests I've been trying to get. So I want to thank everyone for sowing the seed. My phone has really been going off. I'm just overwhelmed and excited about what God is doing and what he's going to continue to do with this forum, with Real Talk with Cindy Barber. And I thank everyone for coming on. My mother is on. I think my father is on. My two sisters have been on. My brother-in-law is on. A family affair that they support me. And it's so important to have family with you and supporting you. And then my cousin Richard is here, and I have other cousins. And Harold Thompson is on.
Harold. Oh, Harold Thompson. Harold. Oh, I am so inspired. Growing up, listening to Harold, I was like, he does it so smoothly.
Doesn't he?
God bless you, Harold. Definitely. God damn.
Harold has always been smooth. And I had him on along with Darren Miller, and I thank God for them. Joseph Stevens is on. It's just so many people that's on. So I thank you so much for your time, and get some rest, and we will be in touch, and love you much, and love everyone. And thank you so much for your offering sowing a seed into me tonight. And thank you, Pastor Ford. And we definitely want that master class. So I'll stay in touch with you with that in any way that I could be helpful. We definitely want that master class. I already have two questions in my mind that I think would be good topics.
Okay.
So I'll be in touch. And I want to say goodnight to everyone and look forward to seeing you on tomorrow night at 8:00 with Hearing from the Prophets. God bless you. Have a wonderful
night. Good night. Thank you, Sydney.
You're welcome. Thank you.